fasten your seatbelts, because here is James Brown.
Welcome to a new episode of the vlog. Welcome to episode 3 of the James Brown story. James Brown, of course, had a career so vast and so important that I thought he had just too much story to tell to compress it into just one episode. So here we are in episode 3, which, spoiler alert, will not be the last episode. By 1968, James Brown's influence was vast. He not only had multiple million-selling singles and sold-out concerts across not only America, but the globe. But in 1967, he had bought a radio station in Knoxville, and he'd rebranded it to WJBE for James Brown Enterprises. And by the end of the 1960s, he'd purchased two more, one in Augusta, Georgia, and then one in Baltimore, Maryland as well. He had just released in the summer of 1968 his smash hit, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, which had become an incredible anthem. So his music was not only incredibly fun and easy to dance to, it also was telling a profound message that was very important. His original group of backing singers, the Famous Flames, had left him in June of 1968, but he was still going strong alongside the incredible James Brown Orchestra, with such members as the phenomenal drummer Clyde Stubblefield, the amazing band leader Maceo Parker, who was also the show MC around that time. You had the great Pee Wee Ellis, and then you of course had the newest addition to the band, trombonist Fred Wesley, who would go on to become the band leader. In 1969, James Brown and his band had multiple huge hits again. They'd Give It Up or Turn It Loose, and they also had Mother Popcorn. Mother Popcorn being an enormous hit, but James Brown was actually kind of annoyed that these dancey songs were so easy to sell, while his deeper, more politically motivated songs, like World, were, while beloved by his fans, not selling quite as well.
This is a big hit of yours right now, isn't it?
Well, I hope you'll accept it, because it's really unexplainable, because I've recorded so many meaningful tunes, tunes that really mean something and saying something, but this just speaks about a dance. We call it popcorn, and since it's so beautiful, I dedicated her by saying Mother Popcorn.
James Brown.
He continued to tour with his James Brown Orchestra until March of 1970, when there was a bit of an uprising in his band. Basically, everybody was, well, not getting paid, at least not getting paid properly. And in March of 1970, probably a majority of the members of the James Brown Orchestra quit on the spot. And I do mean on the spot. I'm talking like the day of a gig. Now, around this time, Bobby Bird, formerly of the Famous Flames, had just rejoined the group as a sort of early version of a hype man, kind of, which you'd see a lot of rappers having. That was sort of Bobby Bird's place in this group. He'd also play some organ parts and sing some backup vocals. And he'd act as not so much a band leader, but a bit of a touring manager as well, sort of. And it wound up being his job to wrangle a new band to replace all these James Brown Orchestra members. And I mean, Fred Wesley was gone. Clyde Stubblefield was gone. Maceo Parker was gone. And many more. Maceo Parker, by the way, was replaced as MC by James Brown's longtime cape man and personal valet, Danny Ray. And God love Danny Ray, one of the greatest MCs in the business. And to fill out the rest of his band, the group that was assembled was pretty awesome. He got a bunch of members of a group called the Pacemakers to fill in. These included the Collins brothers, Catfish Collins on guitars, and, of course, Bootsy Collins on the bass, who would gain tons of notoriety over the course of the rest of the decade as a member of not only the James Brown Orchestra, now rechristened as the JBs, but also later on, he would become a member of Parliament Funkadelic, and then he'd have his own solo career that was very successful. I, by the way, highly recommend watching Mike Judge's show, Tales from the Tour Bus, and particularly its two-part series on James Brown and a standalone episode on Bootsy Collins to sort of understand this period of James Brown's career, and particularly the stories around how this lineup, the original lineup of the band now known as the JBs, came to be. It's a pretty cool story. Yeah, I highly recommend you check that out. Jabbo Starks also joined the group as drummer, although I think he was actually already touring with the James Brown Orchestra beforehand, but he sort of filled in the Clyde Stubblefield role as lead drummer. That sounds weird to say, but James always had two drummers on stage. One of them supplying the main groove and the other one adding some fills. And sometimes on some songs, they just had both drummers rocking out the groove to create a really unique sound. It was really cool. Now, one of the first recordings for this new version of the James Brown Band was this song, Get Up, or in parentheses, I Feel Like Being a Sex Machine, otherwise just known as Sex Machine. Two-part single, as many songs around that time were, and that just became, it wasn't his biggest selling single, but it might be just one of the most quintessential songs from that time period, as well as just one of the most quintessential funk songs of all time. And it is that longtime James Brown sideman, Bobby Bird, whose voice you hear on the Sex Machine single, singing the distinctive Get On Up part. Get on up. Get up, get on up, stay on the scene, get on up, like a sex machine, get on up. And you hear him again in a similar role in a follow-up hit, Get Up, Get Into It, Get Involved.
Everybody over there!
Get on up!
Everybody right there!
Get into it!
Everybody right there!
Get involved!
Everybody hit it!
And it's hard to imagine that this was a brand new band, sort of just starting to get to know James Brown, and more than that, just starting to get used to the spotlight. The Pacemakers were by no means a huge band around that time. They were just a club scene band that was known particularly for doing really spot-on covers of James Brown material, hence why they were chosen to fill that role. They had many more hits after that as well on songs like Superbad, Soul Power, Talking Loud and Saying Nothing, Hot Pants, and more. Although this original lineup of the group was only around for a year. Oh, it's also worth noting that after just a few months of being away, Fred Wesley rejoined the group in approximately December of 1970 and would go on to be the band leader of the JBs. In early 1971, after just about a year together, the original lineup of the JBs disbanded as well. This incident included not only another pay dispute, but also Bootsy Collins was, well, on the LSD pretty heavily, which kind of influenced major parts of his image and his style in the coming years. But at this point, James Brown was having none of it. James Brown had a strict no drugs, no alcohol policy, particularly on stage, but he would pretty much at the very least fine you if, for example, he's found band members smoking weed backstage, which would happen occasionally. They would be fined. Now, by the end of the 1970s, James would have some drug problems of his own, but not yet. By this point, he was running a very strict operation, which he always did, by the way. I would almost describe James Brown's approach to band leading over the years as militarized. But yes, another shakeup of James Brown's band. Certain key members of the group remained, including, of course, Fred Wesley, famed band leader, who would be listed on certain new singles by this group, just as Fred Wesley and the JBs. The Fred Wesley and the JBs band name was actually responsible for several charting singles in the first half of the 70s, most notably on tunes like Gimme Some More and Doing It to Death, aka Gonna Have a Funky Good Time, but that was a little bit later. Also, it's worth noting that in this 1971 version of the group, one new member was bassist Fred Thomas. Now, Fred Thomas is famous for being among the longest tenured members of James Brown's band. As you can tell from this segment, which, by the way, this episode of the James Brown story was the hardest for me to research due to all the band changes and all that stuff. James Brown was keen on hiring, firing, and often paying band members so poorly that they themselves would quit, and creating such a complicated list of performers throughout the history. But Fred Thomas stayed on and stayed in the James Brown Orchestra, or excuse me, the JBs, for 35 years until James Brown eventually passed away in 2006. And then longer. I mean, Fred Thomas is still, to this day, a member of the new JBs, who tour around America, keeping James Brown's legacy alive. Anyway, the first single that this version of the JBs recorded was the song Hot Pants. Hot Pants. It was recorded on King Records, or rather recorded on James Brown's brand new label, People Records. Yes, James Brown even started a label at this point, although he'd flirted with the concept before with Try Me Records in 1963, and with Brownstone Records briefly in 1970. People Records was a new concept for James Brown to control even more of the record-making process on his own, although it was distributed by King Records briefly. Like I said, this new version of the band's first single, I think, was Hot Pants. That would also go on to be James Brown's last single for King. James Brown was involved with King Records for over 15 years. It was the first label that he signed to in 1955, although he was initially assigned to their subsidiary, Federal Records. He then moved on to the King's main label. But in 1971, his contract expired, and instead of renegotiating with King, he elected to sign with Polydor Records. And Polydor not only bought out James Brown's contract, but also purchased the People Records label, James Brown's new independent label. So everything from People Records shifted to Polydor as well. And so the first thing they did for Polydor was to re-record the song Hot Pants and some other tracks to be released on the Hot Pants LP, which I have right up there, which was his first LP for Polydor, and began a 10-year period recording for that label. There was one sort of casualty to this label changeover that makes me a little bit sad, and that is the Love Power Peace live album. It was planned to be a triple live album that showcased not only James Brown's Star Time set, but also many performances by other singers and members of his band. It was to be an awesome set. They went as far as to mix the album and make test pressings of it before James Brown's label switch prompted the album to never be able to be released until the 90s. Love, Power, Peace, which was, by the way, recorded at the Olympia Theater in Paris, France in 1971 in a concert which I believe you can find video from on YouTube as well. But they did eventually release a live album in 1971 on Polydor, and that album is called Revolution of the Mind, aka Live at the Apollo, Volume 3. So that's pretty cool. That's definitely worth having. James Brown continued to have more hits in 1971 and 72. Just never stopped. Again, for a man whose first hit was all the way back in 1956, it's amazing. He just keeps seeming to gather steam. His career virtually never seems to lapse in popularity. He just goes up and up and up, for now at least. And his next few singles were big hits as well. Songs like Escapism, like Make It Funky, Talking Loud and Saying Nothing, and his enormous 1972 hit, Get on the Good Foot, one of his biggest hits ever. So let's just take a look at where James Brown's career sits in 1972. He has a total empire. Around this time, if he wants to release some new music, he writes a song, he can go into one of his studios, record music himself with his producers, with his band, or excuse me, he was the producer, but with his engineers, his band. He then could ship these master recordings to his pressing plants, release them on his record label, People Records, and at least in 3 markets in the U.S. South, he could play them on his recording studios. Hey, what up? It's Graham from the future who's been editing this video for too long. Apparently, I can't speak English. What I meant to say is that in 3 U.S. markets, he could even play these songs on his own radio stations. One in Knoxville, Tennessee, one in Augusta, Georgia, and one in Baltimore, Maryland. And also, like I said, he did not refrain from getting political, but it was around this time that, well, politicians began to be scared of him. Began to be scared that he had this sort of all-powerful ability to get his message out there completely on his own. I guess at this time they were afraid of overly radicalizing certain parts of the population. In retrospect, politicians had no real reason to be afraid. James Brown was a self-made black man in America in the 1970s, spreading a really positive message that was really needed around the time. But, you know, leave it to politicians to try to get a little bit scared by that, particularly in the American South in the early 1970s. What can you say? In any case, I'm not going to delve into that too much in this episode. Going to talk about that in, yes, that's right, episode 4, which I promise I'll make real soon. I am just endlessly fascinated by James Brown's career in researching for this series and in just researching his career over the last several years of my life just for fun. I'm gonna have to put him as the single most interesting figure in the history of pop/rock music. And it's weird to say pop/rock music because James Brown's style never fully fit into those genres. It's hard to put him into any genre that he himself did not invent. James Brown, basically the inventor of funk, basically the inventor of his new breed of soul, and would continue to innovate in the genre in the coming years. Now, I will say, James Brown's career, as I said, seems to be going in just an endlessly ascending scale of popularity and influence, and that would not continue forever. By the mid-1970s, things would begin to falter in James Brown's professional and personal life, and I'll cover that in the next episode. But his hits had not dried up. There are more hits to come. And just so much more to talk about. Thanks so much for watching this series. This series has been very fun for me to make. I'll catch you guys again in episode 4. For those of you who don't know, I am a professional musician myself. You can check out links to where I can find my music, where it's sold or streamed online in the description. Thanks for watching. Like this video if you like what you saw. Subscribe to this channel if you've been enjoying my videos and want to see more music history content, of which I have a lot. You can even ring the notification bell if you would like to be notified whenever I upload a new video, which will be very soon. Thanks so much. Catch you again real soon.